Lots of wonderful things happen around the Christmas time of the year, the Christmas season. It's all good. God gave us the greatest gift he could possibly give, and that started the giving. So people here this evening were received some wonderful gifts, and just were really thrilled. The beat goes on, and Christmas is still a great, wonderful time of the year. Still seemed a little weird doing this virtually, but I'll do the very best I can. We'll try to get this to you as well as we can. But again, thank you for joining us and being here and worshiping with us in this Christmas season and time of year. Hope the Christmas season was good for you and all your family, and we're all staying safe. I'm always amazed after the Christmas season is over with and you see the news articles about the people who don't like Christmas because it's the worst time of the year for them, that their family doesn't get together, or they can't get together with their family, and it's just really a bad time. I just really feel so bad for them because it's such a special time to me that I just feel bad that anybody is not having a really, really great time and not able to get together and feel thankful and just have a sense of joy. You know you're getting older when you hunt through the channels and you find a Christmas special going on, and the country music people are jazzing it up a little bit, and they take the Christmas carols and go, and you're just jumping up and down and saying, no, no, don't do that. Sing it like it's supposed to be. I certainly can tell my age by the way I react to those things. I just want things to be so right, like they've always been. And love the Christmas carols. A lot of good thought and message in them, but I like for them to be sung right. But that's one opinion, and I'm sure there's millions of others out there that really like the way they jazz it up and change it a little bit. Yes, I have accepted the call to be your minister, be your full-time pastor. The worship committee, or the search committee, met with us this past week, and so we have agreed to move here. Don't know exactly what that timetable will be, but soon I will be becoming part of the community, and we'll be becoming your full-time pastor whenever we get past all of this and get open back up again and do some things that we really want to do, I hopefully be here for you. That's our plans. At my age, you don't make any things sure, but anyway, we're excited. We're excited to come back to Chillicothe and excited to be part of the church and excited to be with you, working together to spread the word of the Lord and spread the love of Jesus Christ. Apologize for the outfit. I should have a red jacket and a green shirt on, but I don't have. And if I had any Christmas clothes, well, I guess I wore a mask, so I'm pretty vanilla today. So you'll just have to forgive me for that. However, I do have a couple of jokes. Sorry that I wasn't coming up with any jokes there for a while, but Margaret Black, who's one of our friends that lives in King City, knew that had been in the church when we were hiking the Grand Canyon, and she knew that we'd hiked it several times, so she sent us a little story about a lady who was hiking the canyon and was so enamored with the view that she walked off the edge of the trail and was clinging to the branch of a tree there that had grown into the side of the mountain. And she said, oh Jesus, help me, please. And this voice says, yes, I will help you. Just to show your faith in me, let go of the branch, and I will help you. She said, okay, can I speak to your dad? Yeah, that was good. And the editor of our newspaper, he has quite a sense of humor, and on his editorial page, he had the story about he had bought his mother-in-law a gift a few years that was a plot in the local cemetery, and he had given it to her as a Christmas gift. Well, they exchanged gifts back and forth every year, and so the next year he didn't get her anything. And after they had opened their gifts, she mentioned that he didn't get her anything. And he said, well, you never used the one I gave you last year. So I got a big kick out of that. I thought that was really good. All right, during the Advent season, we light the candles, hope, faith, peace, joy, and love, as to signify what Jesus brings to the earth. We really haven't got to cover those really, really well, so I thought I'd kind of lift up joy and love today. And I looked up joy in the back of the Bible and went to several different places, but I was really surprised to find that Jesus mentions joy a lot of times when he's talking to his disciples about his going away, and he's going to be gone. He's going to come back and see him, and then they're not going to see him anymore, but he will be in and out, and the disciples have no idea what he's talking about, but he says, hey, I'm not going to leave you alone. I will give you the Holy Spirit who will be with you forever, and your joy will be great. Your joy will be complete. The 15th chapter of the Gospel of John, Jesus talks about being the vine and the branches. And he says this in verse 9, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's command and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be complete in you, and that your joy may also be complete. My command is this: love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know about his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I have learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command, love one another. I was kind of surprised that, that Jesus would be telling his disciples that his going away and his dying and dying on the cross would make their joy complete. But then he gave them this command to love one another as I have loved you. And that's one of the commands that has really been special to me that I have really taken into my heart and tried to live by. What's the thing that brings you the most joy? When you think of joy, what do you think of joy as being? I think joy is something that kind of bubbles over. I see a joyful person as a really bubbly person, one that's just got all kinds of energy and has all kinds of love and really special person that really lifts other people up and other people just feel good because they're around that person. In playing football, I played the two back, which meant I ran to the left all the time, and the one back ran to the right constantly. Well, one time we ran the 1-2-5, which was give the ball to me, and I ran left, and I broke through the line, and I saw something that I'd never seen before, and it was an open space. My teammates had been out there and blocked and opened up a space for me, and I ran through that, and all I could see was green grass. Well, as I got to the green grass and started running, the crowd just came alive, and I could hear the roar of the crowd, and hear everybody yelling and screaming and hollering. And I don't think I've ever ran that fast in my life. I wish I would have had a timer on it, because I know I never did run that fast again. But I thought I was going to run so fast I wouldn't be able to keep my legs going to be able to keep me up, like Daniel Jones did earlier, the quarterback for the Giants. Ran about 70 yards and fell down. That's what I thought, that's the way, kind of the way I felt. But I made it to the end zone. But that was exhilarating. That was really exhilarating. That was the first time I had ever really broke loose and got to the green grass. But oh my gosh, the green grass looked good. But is that the joy we're really looking for? Yeah, it was joy. It was a wonderful experience. But is that the joy we're really looking for? The joy of holding your firstborn baby for the first time. Looking at all the experience, looking at all the future, looking at all the possibilities that that baby might have, and you know your blood is going to be carried on through that child, whether it's a boy or a girl, your blood's going to go forth. It's really a special time, and that's a joy that just kind of goes beyond understanding. When your child takes his first step, and your first child takes its first step, that's a joy because you know this child is just getting started and going to do great things in the world. What an adventure to raise children, raise a family. Just wouldn't give that up for anything in the world. What a wonderful joy. I also thought when the second one takes its first step, you look at it completely differently because you think, oh my gosh, this kid's going to be into everything. But by that time, you've pretty well got the house child-proof, so it wasn't such a big deal as trying to run around in front of the first one and rescue all the little whatnots and the little glass and trickly things that would break. So. But the second one is definitely different than the first. I suppose the joy that comes to me that would be maybe the most meaningful was baptizing my oldest three granddaughters. My oldest granddaughter decided that she was going to join the church and make a confession of faith. And folks asked her where she wanted to be baptized, and she said, I want Grandpa Kenny to baptize me. Well, they got to talk about it, and a couple of days later, then the second girl decided she would join the church also. Well, a couple of days later, the third girl decided it was time for her to join the church. So they came from western Nebraska to King City, Missouri, and I baptized those three girls, and what an awesome experience. Just really, really great. And I thought to myself when I was baptizing those girls, we get to spend eternity together. Wow. That is just out there. That is just very, very special. And I think that's my experience, my greatest joy, was baptizing those girls. Not that I didn't enjoy watching my boys play athletics or doing band or choir or things like that, or accomplishing things, graduating from high school, graduating from college. One of my goals in life was to have all of my boys get a college education because I didn't, and I got to do that. And wow, what a pleasure and what a joy that was to see them do well. They've all never been in jail as far as I know, and they've all done well, good, solid people, good, solid citizens. So really proud of that and watching them. That's always a joy. Your family is certainly a joy to you, feeling a sense of accomplishment. Just wonder what God thought about Jesus. But we remember when God spoke to Jesus and said, this is my son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. This is my son with whom I am well pleased. Listen Jesus told a parable about a man who went to had a big farm, and he decided he was going to go south for the winter, like somebody in the middle part of Missouri would go to Florida. And he had 6 or 8 employees, and he told them, "Hey, I'd like for you to build a fence and cut brush and kind of clean up some things around here, and maybe do a little spading in the garden, and clean the garden spot off, prune the orchard, just a lot of jobs around there to do." And then he left with no one supervising. Well, they started in working, and building fence is no fun when you're digging post holes or stringing barbed wire. Pruning an orchard is not very exciting, and cutting brush is even worse, even duller than that. And the guy said, "There's nobody here. Let's go to town and rest a little while, and then we'll come back and finish." And that went on every day for a while, and pretty soon they were spending all day, every day in town, playing cards and just visiting with people and having a good time and not doing anything. Well, two of the hands stayed on and kept working and doing what they were supposed to do, and the other 6 went to town and were just having a good time and not doing any work at all, even though they were getting paid for this. Lo and behold, the farmer decides he's had enough of Florida about the first week of March, and he comes home a couple of months before he's supposed to. And when he arrives home, there's only 2 guys working, and they really haven't got much done. And he said, "Hey, what's going on here? What happened? Where are the other guys?" And they said, "Well, they're in town." "Well, what are they doing?" "Well, they're just visiting, playing cards, and just hanging around town." And the farmer was very, very angry, as well as the king in the story of Jesus, and punished those servants severely. I kind of understand that that parable, and there's been several times that my wife has come home and caught me doing the dishes or cleaning the bathroom or picking up the house or mowing the yard or things like that. And you know, I thought about that parable and I thought, what am I going to be doing for the kingdom when Jesus returns? And that's something that we all need to think about. What are we going to be doing in the kingdom when Jesus comes back? When Jesus says, "Make my joy complete," what's he talking about? What's the rules laid down here? Well, in the scripture it says, "I have kept my Father's command as he commanded me. This other commandment I give to you." But Jesus had kept the commands of God to the letter. Then he gave us one more: love one another as I have loved you. So I think that's the rule that we have to play by, that we're going to play by, that Jesus' commands are this: that we follow the Father's commands, and that we love one another as he loved us. Well, how did Jesus love us, and how are we supposed to love one another? Well, Jesus gave up his life for us. He gave up everything. He gave up everything he had. He gave up all his time. He gave up all his possessions. He gave up his life. He gave everything. He totally gave it over to us. And that command is what we have to follow, what we're asked to follow. Are we working on that? Are we thinking about that as the first and foremost thing in our life? Is that what really, really matters? Sue always does a devotion every morning from Lloyd Ogilvie. And this morning she was sharing with me this devotion that she had a couple of days ago. It has to do with Christmas. And it said, what if you waited for a year, you worked a year, to pick out a very, very special gift for this friend? And you went and bought that gift, and you wrapped it up the very best you could. Put your very best wrapping paper and bows on it. And you gave it to your friend. And your friend sets it aside and doesn't open it. And doesn't ever open it in your presence. How would you feel? How would you feel about that? Have we really unwrapped the present of Jesus? Have we really studied and found out and investigated everything we could possibly know about Jesus? Have we given him of our time? Have we given him of our talents? Have we given him of our resources? Of what he deserves? Have we really unwrapped the gift of Jesus? Or are we just letting it lay there? And maybe we're afraid to go there. Maybe they're afraid of what God would ask us to do if we really knew and really understood. Eighth chapter of the book of Romans says, there is nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Jesus brought hope, faith, peace, joy, and love to the earth. All he asks is that we believe and we trust in him, that we give over ourselves to him and surrender ourselves completely to him. And he says with that, his joy will be complete. By being here today and being with us, you're helping to make God's joy complete and Jesus' joy complete. Let's do more. We can. Let's pray. Father God, you've given us your most precious possession. I cannot imagine giving up a son and how much that must have hurt, how much that must have damaged. But you did it for us. And Lord, we thank you. And may we rededicate ourselves right now to doing our best the rest of our life to make your joy complete. In Jesus, our Savior's name. Isn't it an awesome thing to have the opportunity to serve the Lord? Wow. We can serve the Lord as Jesus did. Jesus told his disciples when he was going away, you are going to do even greater things than I have. So service to the Lord is very, very important. And bringing joy to the Lord, that's just neat. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus gave his disciples a piece of bread. He took it and broke it, gave thanks to God, and said, take, eat. This is my body given for you. In the same way, he took the cup, asked God to bless it, and said, take, drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant given for you. Jesus did these things that we may revere him and proclaim that he is our Lord and Savior. And he is the Lord and Savior of every person in the world who will accept him and believe and put their faith and trust in him. The bread and the wine. Thank you for being with us this morning. Sorry we can't be together, but this is the best we can do. Hope you enjoyed the message. And hope you'll think about really giving God joy and making Jesus' joy complete. Let's pray. Father God, you ask so little that we just love. And we seem to be unable to comprehend that and really take it to heart. It's still in our head. Maybe it'll get to our heart someday. Help us and bless us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.